A very good afternoon to everyone. I, Mohini Sharma, on the behalf of International Center for Automotive Technology and Aspire Management, let me extend a very warm welcome to all of you. It's our privilege to have you all with us today for this webinar on Simulation Assisted Design of Fuel Cell EV. ITAT's International Center for Automotive Technology, located in the Northern Automotive Hub of India, is a leading world-class automotive testing, certification, and R&D service provider under the aegis of NETRIP, Government of India. Aspire stands for Automotive Solutions Portal for Industry Research and Education, is a technology platform. Aspire has taken an initiative of conducting the webinars for students on various topics, which is a part of celebration of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, which is 75th anniversary of our independence, of aiming to reinforce the Atmanirbhar Bharat in technology area. Through this webinar, we have set a virtual stage to convert the industry to indulge and acquaint ourselves with emerging simulation assisted design of fuel cell EV. Now I would like to introduce Dr. Dheeraj Mahajan. Dr. Dheeraj Mahajan completed his post graduation in advanced manufacturing processes from NIT Warangal and PhD from IIT Kanpur. Currently, he is assistant professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, IIT Roorkee. We will start the presentation now. And if you have any question during the presentation, just write them in question section. We will take the questions on your behalf at the end of the session, or we'll revert all the answers on your email IDs. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. This. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So. Fine. So I'm switching off my webcam because of the low bandwidth. Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Okay. Fine. Thank you. So, is my screen clearly visible? Nothing is coming,
yes,
in between, I believe. Okay. Because there's a panel. Okay. Fine. So, good evening, rather good afternoon, everyone. So, I'm Dr. Dheeraj Mahajan. I'm associate professor at IIT Roorkee. And what I'm going to present here today is the role of simulations on designing of fuel cell electric vehicle. So first of all, looking at our background, fuel cell electric vehicles are relatively new, rather very new in Indian education sector. And since this presentation is mainly for students, so I'm kind of explaining more details about what includes, what are the components are there in the fuel cell electric vehicles, and then I will be showing the role of simulations in developing both the component level components of the fuel cell electric vehicle and as well as the system level design of which is basically the fuel cell electric vehicle itself. So going ahead, before I go ahead, I would like to acknowledge the contribution made by my students, by my collaborators, and here the work I will be showing for Ujjwal, then for my PhD student Yash, Tushta, Yashjit, and Sumit. These are master students, and Yash is a collaborator. So I will start. So I'm heading the Roorkee Mechanics and Material Lab at IIT Roorkee, and it's a request that please don't take pictures or make videos because of some unpublished work that I'm going to show. Anyway, I have sanitized the results that I'm presenting here, but still I think we will have a greater discussion after the talk. Okay, sorry, this is the... Yeah, so what I want to start with is that why hydrogen? Suddenly, why suddenly hydrogen has become so prominent in news as well as world over? So hydrogen holds the potential to provide clean, safe, affordable, and secure energy from abundant domestic resources. It means we are going to become independent if we start working with hydrogen. like we will become import independent of for our energy requirement that we are doing in large quantity. So a dream for India is probably a hydrogen economy, and this hydrogen economy includes four pillars like hydrogen infrastructure, hydrogen storage, hydrogen enabled technologies, and hydrogen production. So in these four pillars, however, this dream has never been realized before because there are issues involved with hydrogen. So with all four pillars, I'll say. So the first pillar, hydrogen infrastructure. Hydrogen is very nasty for metallic materials. And then there's an issue called hydrogen embrittlement, which basically leads to deterioration of mechanical properties of metals. So we need to be very careful when we are dealing with hydrogen. Second thing is being hydrogen having low density, we need to store hydrogen at very high density by, like, for example, in very high pressure systems. So the tank that I'm showing you here, and later on also detail I'm going to present for Toyota vehicle, this typical tank, hydrogen storage tank used in fuel cell electric vehicle. This is a 700 bar or 70 MPa high pressure tank. So this is being used, and in India till date we have not been able to make such kind of advanced storage system for hydrogen. And then third difficulty that we have is basically the high pressure, high power density fuel cells, which is basically the heart of a fuel cell electric vehicle, which provides the electricity to run this electric fuel cell electric vehicle. So this also we need to still to achieve a very high power density fuel cell system, which is still not available in India, but people are working in this direction. And the last one in this fourth pillar is hydrogen production. So in this hydrogen production, we are still to avail various sources. Like we want to develop sustainable methodologies for hydrogen production, like green hydrogen. People are talking about where we can produce hydrogen from solar energy by water splitting and all those things. But in addition to that, we can also use the waste, bio waste that we are generating from our agriculture sector, or even plastic waste. So any material that has a hydrogen involved, so we can extract the hydrogen out from these things. So this way we can generate a very very intensive economy based on hydrogen, where like we are talking about completely zero emission systems here. So hydrogen provides this opportunity, and all the countries have realized the opportunity with hydrogen now. So that's the reason why hydrogen is now so much in the news. So this is what India is also targeting, a hydrogen economy, but we still have to tackle these four hurdles that in the four sections of hydrogen economy. Okay. So just to enthuse the students to look at hydrogen, I'm just presenting basically the global hydrogen startup map. So a lot of startups are coming up in this area. So you can see that like there are electrolyzers which can generate hydrogen, then compressions where you need to compress the hydrogen at very high pressure, and distribution, how do you take hydrogen from one place to other, that's one area. And then not only fuel cell, but we can use IC engine which are hydrogen fueled. So there is a startup in these domains also. And of course, storage, as I mentioned, storage is a big area what people are looking at. Fuel cell application is a big area. And then production from H2O, water, on-site generation of hydrogen, other kind of production. So there are plenty of startups working in this area. And it's my personal dream that we should see more startups in this area. So this is just, I wanted to give you an overview of that. Okay. So next is like why fuel cell electric vehicles. Now I'm giving you three pictures. That fuel cell electric vehicle is meant for everything, like whatever you think from a two wheeler. So this is an advanced bike showcased by Hero. I think one year back in Auto Expo. And then this is a Hyundai Motor Nexo car, which is hydrogen powered. And Nikola in US is doing wonder with this fuel cell electric vehicle trucks. So you may not have heard about trucks built of batteries. So there's a reason to that, because battery kind of has a very high low power density, and then we need the volume occupied by batteries is going to be huge compared to the fuel cell electric vehicle system. So not only trucks, we can power aeroplanes, we can power trains also with hydrogen. So fuel cell has a huge potential in that area. So okay, so why fuel cell electric vehicles? So these are hydrogen powered vehicles, have significant higher range of travel compared to battery. This is one advantage. And then time to refill hydrogen tanks is very low, like less than 5 minutes. A new standard talks about 3 minutes actually. So with respect to battery, this is not possible, where even the high speed charging and all, you need minimum 1 hour to charge it. And then of course quiet operation, high power density, and India has a huge potential in green hydrogen production with its renewable power generation capability. So completely holistically, hydrogen is providing a complete solution for our energy requirement, especially for our vehicular energy requirement. And also it provides an opportunity to get rid of the pollution caused by that large number of vehicles we have on Indian roads. So this is another example. Like in the trucks also, you can see that there are main three big players, like Hyzon. This is getting popular in Europe, and Hyundai is a South Korean company. Accent is their truck, and Nikola in US. So these are the trucks that are coming up in the market based on hydrogen. And I also want to tell that the innovations in the hydrogen domain started happening like 20-25 years back, where many of the leading automobile companies have already made great contribution. One of them is this is the number of patents filed in this domain of hydrogen fuel cell electric vehicle, and then you can see that it peaked around 2014. Means it also gives you a hint that a lot of innovation has already happened in this area, but still India is far away from in-house innovations in this area. So there's a great potential to indigenize the technology and to bring down the cost, which is the only hurdle where India need to focus in order to popularize this technology. So here I want to show the various contribution of in the patents from various companies. Like you can see that Toyota is the leader in this domain. So and of course other companies are also participating, but Toyota has made great contribution. So to begin with, I'm going to spend some time, like say next 20 minutes, to explain what actually is fuel cell electric vehicle. And then the remaining part of out of my time, I'm going to show some simulation results that we are doing at my lab. And so to start with, this is basically I've taken from the Toyota poster, because I think without the explanation of this, you people will not be able to appreciate it. So I'm going to spend some time of it on it. So So the fuel cell vehicle, what does it consist of? So first of all, this is the heart of the fuel cell stack, and this is Toyota is mass producing this fuel cell, which is compact in size and has the world top level output performance, output density in the sense it can generate 3.1 kilowatt of power from 1 liter. So now you can imagine that. So the batteries and all should not be of this power density. So and then the maximum output from this small size fuel cell is 114 kilowatt, which is amazingly high. And the second major component in the fuel cell, of course the fuel cell electric vehicle have a battery also, because it need to support the fuel cell when the fuel cell is not performing up to the mark, and the battery come into picture. And then the battery here, for example, they are using nickel metal hydride battery, which stores energy recovered from the deceleration and assist fuel cell stack output during acceleration. So this is the two important thing that you have to see, because when you need to accelerate, the fuel cell power cannot be generated instantaneously. So this is where you need the mix of power coming from the fuel cell as well as the battery. So during acceleration, the battery is going to support the vehicle motor, and when you are cruising, so fuel cell will take over, and to optimize the usage of hydrogen, That's a basic thing that we have to understand between fuel cell and the role of fuel cell and battery in fuel cell electric vehicle. So next is the major important thing. Other is the hydrogen storage. This is where high pressure hydrogen storage tank will come up. So this is tank store hydrogen as fuel, and the nominal working pressure is 700 bar. Why we need to store 700 bar? Because if you are able to store 700 bar, only then you will be able to say because only then you will be able to store respectable hydrogen, which will provide a run to the fuel cell electric vehicle for more than 600 kilometers, which is equivalent to the gasoline or what do you say, the conventional IC engine based vehicle. So here also you note down that tank storage density is only 5.7% weight. So tank is also still taking consuming a lot of volume in the vehicle. So we need to take care of this while designing a vehicle. And then the other major component is the motor, like where the power, power is consumed and the motor then converts that power to power the wheels. So this is motor driven by electricity generated by fuel cell stack and supplied by the battery. So the battery is the supplier, fuel cell generates it. And then maximum output is 113 kilowatts. So you can see that fuel cell stack maximum output is 114. And this the maximum output here is 113. And then the maximum torque here is 335 Newton meter. So next is the power control unit. This is a mechanism to optimally control both the fuel cell output under various operation condition and drive battery charging and discharging. So this power control take care of giving the actual power required for the motor by combining the power from in a certain way from the fuel cell and battery. And last thing that is important, which is the fuel cell booster converter, which converts the voltage from the fuel cell to high voltage, which is these motors are basically high voltage motors. So this is where the booster is going to play a role. So these are the major aspects of the fuel cell vehicle system. And okay. So yeah, so the heart of the fuel cell, as I mentioned, is basically the fuel cell stack. What does the fuel cell stack has? So it is basically there are various kind of fuel cell stacks. So the one the Toyota is using is polymer electrolyte fuel cell. So this is the power ratings and everything is given. So this is the full fuel cell booster I was talking about. So this is just associated with the fuel cell directly here. And so these are the auxiliary component, basically the hydrogen circulating pump, because the hydrogen need to go inside the fuel cell stack to be able to generate electricity by reacting with the oxygen from the air or there. So this complete set. So this is the operating principle for the complete fuel cell electric vehicle. So in this case, for example, let's see that first step is the air oxygen is taken in here, and then this air is then reaches the fuel cell stack, where the oxygen from the air is now used to generate the power, and where this is the hydrogen storage tank. So this step two is oxygen and hydrogen supplied to the fuel cell stack. Step three is electricity and water generated through the chemical reaction here. You can see that when the fuel cell generate electricity, it gives a water as an output. So this hydrogen is coming from this stored high pressure tank here. And the step four here is the electricity that is generated from the fuel cell stack and the battery combination. So this is supplied to the motor, and this motor is activated and the vehicle moves. The last step, of course, the output, that water is emitted outside the outside vehicle. So two other things that we have to take care of: the hydrogen tank that you are using, the fueling system that you are using for this hydrogen tank, this should be compatible with the refueling infrastructure that you are going to have. So of course in India we don't have the fueling infrastructure yet, but I think soon in next 1 year we are going to see more fueling station coming up with the announcement of by Reliance already. So there's a lot of acceleration in this particular domain. So yeah, so this is just the beginning for the fuel cell vehicle. I also want to spend some more time on the Toyota fuel cell electric vehicle specifications. So here you can see that the cruise range, so this is given 550 kilometers. This is estimated using European drive cycle. according to, and then maximum speed is 178, power per density is 3.1 kilowatt per liter. So this is the world top level. So the Toyota data, and maximum output is a number of tanks for hydrogen storage. This is 2, because if you are able to store hydrogen 2, then only you are able to reach around 5.6 kg of hydrogen. I think this is the number that is there. And the tank storage density is 5.7, motor output, motor torque. So these are the specification you need to understand for the vehicle that, so what kind of axle, what kind of torque you need. So this particular thing should be known to you in the beginning before you start designing your fuel cell electric vehicle. So then, of course, the design is such that it has low center of gravity. So how you are placing your components for the electric the fuel cell electric vehicle, this will design the overall stability of your vehicle. This the vehicle dynamics is another important aspect, so which we need to take care, and this is, this will depend on how we are fixing the various components in our vehicle. So other than this, the driving performance of Mirai is phenomenal. This is what this chart is, these plots are basically telling that. So acceleration from acceleration from 40 to 70 kilometers is just, it takes 3 seconds, and acceleration from 0 to 100 kilometer for Mirai takes around 9 seconds. I think here it's 9.6. So this basically fuel cell hydrogen vehicle ADV. So this is the first model of fuel cell electric vehicle what Toyota came up in 2008, I think. So this is the vehicle performance, and you can see that how they have improved. So this is the latest 2001 model of Toyota Mirai. And other than this, you can see that how, so this is just the drive quality measurement from the Toyota itself. So the Mirai really stands out with the performance in this section also. And now one thing I want to explain here. The plot here basically tells you that what is basically how the fuel cell operate. So and the fuel cell is unfortunately very dependent upon the weather. The performance of the fuel cell is very dependent on the weather. So this particular plot basically tells you that in very cold weather, how does the fuel cell perform? So now you can see that so we are starting the vehicle after 17 hours of parking under like between -20°C. So when you start the vehicle, so it is not that the fuel cell will start powering up to 100% of its capability in the first half second. It is going to take time because there's an electrochemical reaction that is going to happen. So in order to make it fully activated, you need to spend time. So here you can see that the 100% output of the fuel cell is only available after 70 seconds. So now if you see that in the fuel cell specification, we were saying that the motor is 113 kilowatt, and this fuel cell now is not giving output of 114 kilowatt. I think this is just a mix of battery and fuel cell. So now if you want to start, and of course you need to accelerate in the beginning itself. So what do we do? So from where the power is coming? So this is where the mix, the battery that you are choosing should be selected in such a way that for certain time, when the fuel cell is not performing up to its fully capability, the battery is going to take over, and it's going to support the vehicle by supplying the relevant power. So yeah, so this is the acceleration, complete acceleration thing that we are showing here. So yeah, so the power requirement in the beginning will be met by battery, and not only in the beginning, but during the acceleration phase also, the battery the battery is going to play a major role in during that time. So these are important concepts in understanding how this fuel cell electric vehicle work. So these are other specifications which I wanted to just a minute please, yeah, which I wanted to show. So now you can see that it has a top of the world top level of power density, the fuel cell. So this is the 2008 model of the fuel cell stack. So this is 1.4 kilowatt per liter, whereas the latest one is it's 2.2 times better than the first version of the fuel cell stack that Toyota launched in 2008 model. And now, so this is okay, that this is the stack specification, but what makes this stack? So in I think I haven't spent time into that, but STAC is basically an electrochemical system where you have different channels where the hydrogen will flow, and in the other on other side the oxygen or the air will flow. So and within that, so within that there is a gas diffusion layer, there is a polymer electrolyte membrane, there is a catalyst which will split the hydrogen into H plus and electron, and then this electron from the anode side will travel to the cathode side, where the hydrogen H plus will travel from the polymer electrolyte membrane, which has a capability of exclusively letting the H plus only to move from the anode side to the cathode side, and at the catalyst layer, which is basically a platinum. So these are the things that are showing up. In the next slide, I'll show it in more detail. So in the cathode side, this H plus is going to react with the oxygen at the catalyst surface and generate water. So this is where on the cathode side the water is going to go out of these channels, and while the air is flowing in these channels, the water is the output that is coming out. So water produced from the electric power generated tended to block the flow channel, and so these are the things that we can understand by performing simulations, how to design better in order to control the water or letting the water go out quickly. So these are the things that we need to work out in simulation. So in between these layers, what is going on? So this is the electrode. Electrode basically has these components. So the electrode innovation, the electrolyte membrane is made thinner in the 2021 version. The diffusion performance of gas diffusion layer. So this is the gas diffusion layer. This is a porous layer made out of carbon, so this has low density and thinner base material. So on this side, these are the platinum, basically the catalyst that splits the hydrogen into H plus, and then this H plus travel from this side to other side, and again on this catalyst layer, the oxygen and H plus reacts to generate water. So this basically membrane electrode assembly. This is kind of the most important part of the fuel cell stack, because this is where the reactions are going to happen. So now you can see that the fuel cell electric vehicle. Like more than mechanical, it is more of an electrochemical system. So the understanding of the physics and the chemistry going on in the fuel cell is very important in order to improve the performance of such vehicles. So now you can see that, so this 2008 model, the cell voltage and the current density here. So this is a standard plot which tells you the performance of a fuel cell electric stack. So here the new cell is giving us a very high current density. So at low, so this is going to define the power generated from our fuel cell stack. So other than this, there are other factors like I think I'll skip that. So like for example, there's a humidifier where you need to humidify the hydrogen that is coming up into the fuel cell. Because we need to control that the fuel cell membrane should not dry up, because it need to be very in a humid environment in order to operate or this hydrogen transport to happen. So there are various things that Toyota has done, and they have made this humidifier less, this system. So you can see that reduction that they have done, 15 liter, 13 kgs. So I'm just explaining you this because I think you will appreciate what role the simulations have to do in development of the fuel cell electric vehicle. If you understand these things, these specifications that are given, because as young students, it is important to understand that what output you need to see, and then go back on pen and paper and see how you can do that. So this exercise is just on that domain. So this is our fuel cell booster, which is attached to increase the voltage output from the fuel cell. And this fuel cell stack, this has a fuel cell booster here, a booster converter. And then this is the power control, which mixes the power from the fuel cell and the battery. And then it sends the power to the motor. So this is the new innovation, the 650 volt motor that Toyota is using. Okay, So next important part is the hydrogen tank. So yeah, I'll not go into detail what exactly it is, but yeah, of course, this is the hydrogen tank, and then so it has a boss on both sides. So I'll skip this part. And lastly, there's a hydrogen filling refueling to be done for this tanks. And this tank should have this tank information should be transmitted to the hydrogen station. And this the mode in which it is transmitting, like infrared ray transmitter, because the fueling station need to know the existing pressure or the temperature of the hydrogen gas within the tank, and therefore this hydrogen temperature sensors and pressure sensors they need to talk with the fueling station here. So yeah, so overall, so this completes the component level information of a complete fuel cell electric vehicle. So now you can see that of course with improved standard you need to refill the fuel cell electric vehicle in less than or approximately 3 minutes compared to 5 minutes or more earlier. So as per the standards, these are the numbers coming up. Okay, so now looking at what I have discussed, I want to explain what is the role of simulations in this. So how you can play how the simulations that can play to develop can play a role in order to develop more efficient fuel cell electric vehicles. So we need simulations both at the individual component level as well as the system level. So what I'm going to show you in next 10 minutes is basically an overview of what consists of an example. For example, individual component level simulation. For example, this is a fuel cell single cell schematic of a fuel cell. So what does it has? So from the anode side, there's a hydrogen that is going on within these channels, and these channels, what kind of channels you are going to have, this will dictate the output power from this fuel cell. So this hydrogen is there, these are the channels in which the hydrogen is flowing, and this hydrogen is going to pass through this gas diffusion layer, which is a very porous layer, and then within this catalyst, there is a catalyst layer which is a polymer doped with platinum, and when this hydrogen molecule reaches this catalyst layer, so it splits into electron and the hydrogen, and then the hydrogen permeates through this PEM electrode, and this is polyelectrolyte membrane. This is another polymer which is used, and this is a special polymer like Nafion and all, and then this hydrogen then passes through again the catalyst layer, where the electron and the oxygen combines here and then it generates water and the complete circuit is completed. So this is the cathode side and the anode side. So in order to improve the performance, there is a performance increase you can think about to manufacture better electrolyte membrane, where the simulation can play a role, because this is pure chemistry or physics happening here. So you can do quantum mechanics, you can do molecular dynamic simulation in order to identify better electrolyte membrane, and then of course this catalyst layer, this can there are various tools where you can simulate the complete electrochemistry of the fuel cell stack. For example, COMSOL you can use, even ENSYS has a complete module on fuel cell. So what I want to say that of course experimentally what you are simulation what you are doing, you need to validate experimentally also the output. So there is a lot of scope and lot of innovation in fuel cell system at the component level also. So system is okay, the complete fuel cell vehicle is okay, but at this component level there is a lot of room where innovations can be made in order to perform, in order to improve the performance of the fuel cell electric vehicle. And the example that I'm going to give you is just like one of the student work. I'm just going to go quickly as this work is not published yet. So in this thing, like the goal was to develop a 100 watt power rating fuel cell stack, based on metallic bipolar plates. So these bipolar plates, they are generally graphite based, but to have a more high power density of the fuel cell stack, we need to use metallic bipolar plates, because then you can reduce the thickness of the fuel cell bipolar plates, and you can store, you can generate more power from smaller volumes. So this is what Toyota Mirai is using. They are also using same metallic bipolar plates, and of course there are a lot of testing and lot of parameters as per Department of Energy standards which we need to follow in order to manufacture high power density fuel cells. So these should be taken care. So in the next few slides, I'm going to show what finite element simulations can do, what kind of results we can produce. So of course the okay, so this is the system fuel cell stack for 100 kilowatt, which where we calculated the required number of plate and number of the current density that that these plates need to generate. So these are all the components that we generated the CAD modeling of, and then later on we did the finite element simulations of this to validate the design basically, and to validate the material. So all the material that I'm showing here, like gaskets, the metallic plates that we are using, the tie rods we are using, so these are given realistic material properties in order to validate the design of the fuel cell stack. So I'm not going into the property side of it. So these are the single cell components. So these are the gaskets used in our fuel cell stack, and then these can be simulated by giving the right properties to the gasket. And then later on performing, so the role of this tie rod is to generate to make the fuel cell stack gas tight, because this is a multiple channels, multiple cells. So there are 8 cells associated in order to make this 100 watt fuel cell. The dimension I'm not putting here. So now you can see that the hydrogen has to pass through all the 8 channels, 8 cells, and similarly the air has to pass through that. So the gaskets plays a major role from one cell to other cell to make the connection gas tight, but also the tie rods, how much torque you are applying to ensure that these fuel cells are gas tight. So these can be simulated and to validate the material that you are going to use for these stacks. Okay. So here, these are the fuel cell stack, single fuel cell stack components, and then based on that, this is the bipolar plate designs that we are using in order to simulate the behavior. Okay, and so these are some results that we got. We performed the simulations on ANSYS, and we meshed the finite element model for the fuel cell stack, 100 watt fuel cell stack, and then then we give the forces on the washers where the tie rods will be associated. So we are not simulating the tie rod, but we apply the forces and then see the strain distribution within the fuel cell stack. So this work is still ongoing. So we use the quarter model for the fuel cell stack in order to simulate this behavior. So rather than the complete model, we are, due to symmetry, we are using a quarter model in order to see the results, like see how what is going on. So this basically slides tells you the displacements going on. So the model is not yet complete, we are still working on it, and these are basically the contacts where the gasket is meeting the bipolar plates. I'll skip this part. So this is still not complete. So the second example that I want to give is basically the modeling of a system level simulation based design of fuel cell electric vehicle. In this case, the objective is to design a hydrogen powered forklift. So in this generally we have of course we have IC engine based forklift, but they are not good because of these forklift work under very constrained environment of warehouses or factories, and the pollution generated by this forklift can be very harmful for the employees within the constrained environments. So fuel cell electric bike, fuel cell powered forklifts are quite useful, and of course there are other battery powered forklifts are also there, but then the battery charging require a lot of time, and then these batteries are going to have limited life also compared to hydrogen fuel cell forklifts. So from techno-economical point of view, the big companies are now thinking of deploying this hydrogen powered forklift, because they give long term benefit compared to both IC engine based forklift or battery based forklift. So the component of the forklift are basically like you have frame, you have overhead guard. So this is just for the output gases. We are mixing two things here, like the battery should not be shown here. So this is a hydraulic system, forks, this is called carriage, this is called mast. So the major thing what we are trying, so the weight that the forklift has to lift that has to be balanced by the forklift itself. So there are some cases where you can see that the type 4 tank earlier that was shown in the in the fuel cell electric vehicle, they are very lightweight tank. But then there are other tanks like the metallic tanks that you see in the market. So they are very heavy tanks. So though people say that, of course, we need to store large amount of hydrogen. So 700 bar, if you store, you store a lot of hydrogen. But these forklifts are running it in a very for limited time, like say 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers within the factory. It may be advantageous for forklift to have hydrogen storage in metallic tanks, because they provide excess weight that forklift anyway require in order to balance what kind of weight it can lift. So the system design that I'm simulation, I'm not showing the result, but this was our objective, where we want to understand the role of different tanks in order to bring down the cost of the forklift. So quickly what we did, advantages of forklift over electric forklift. So hydrogen can be refilled quickly and easy to at fuel station. Now you can see that due to forklift, hydrogen forklift, the forklift will be available 24/7 compared to electric forklift that need charges, charging maybe 4 to 6 hours in order to become operational. So this becomes a very expensive affairs for companies. So they may have to buy multiple forklifts in order to give 24/7 operation. So this may not be the case for the hydrogen fuel cell. So how do we simulate that? There are various simulation techniques. So at system level modeling. So one of them is the MATLAB Simulink based models, model for forklift. So we kind of developed that model in-house, and then we kind of simulated. So the fuel cell, the motors that we are using, I'll not go into detail. So the motor is 5 kilowatt that we are using in this fuel cell vehicle forklift. So how do you mix power between battery and the fuel cell? That is the key understanding we need to develop, and the whole system level modeling, like how many kilometers it can run, what kind of hydrogen is required in order to give the range, and what kind of drive cycle the forklift is going to have. So based on that drive cycle, you are going to decide what kind of power mix you need to do between the between the fuel cell and the battery. So these are the things that you can simulate within when you do a system level modeling. So this is what we did, and then for example for the power versus time plot for forklift. So this is the power requirement that wattage we are sorry I think there's a mistake here, so this kind of plot you are going to get. So this is what we are getting from the drive cycle of the forklift, which either somebody has to make the drive cycle or as I mentioned, from the European drive cycle repository, these drive cycles will be available. So this is an input for your system design for your MATLAB and Simulink, and this is what how you are going to achieve that with the right mix of the fuel cell power and the battery fuel cell batteries. This will be the key understanding that you need to develop, and because the motor power, so this is the motor power that you are generating. and how you are going to achieve that with this fuel cell and the battery. This will be the key understanding from the simulations. So these are the output from our simulations, like voltage and power requirement that we are getting over current. So I think so using such kind of simulations we can design so kind of this is an output we can get, because once you do a system level modeling, you can find how much hydrogen you need for particular drive range that you need to do. And if you know how much hydrogen you need, then you can decide how much tanks you need for storing that kind of hydrogen. And then the fuel cell stack sizing you will come to know, because if you know what kind of motor you are going to use for doing the job, you need to find, you can find what kind of fuel cell stack power rating and the battery that you need, that you can identify if you do system level modeling. And then of course in the forklift, since we could do the system level modeling, and then you can find what kind of counterweight you need to put and what kind of hydrogen and number of tanks you can put. So yeah, so this is the broad understanding I want to give you from the fuel cell electric vehicles, the role of simulations basically. I think I'm done in order to give an overview for this. So can we have questions also now? Yeah, organizers.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir, for this wonderful session. Now we will move to the question answer session. If you have any queries, please note down in the question section. Sir, we have a question from Gaurav Heda. How yeah. did you simulate hydrogen pump and air recirculating pump?
Sorry, come again.
Sir, how did you simulate hydrogen pump and air recirculating pump?
Okay. Just a minute. Yeah, I think these kind of models are already available in MATLAB Simulink. So I'll not be able to go into particular detail how we did it. But yeah, so these models you can generate yourself, or this will be available in the repository. So I'll prefer to not to share details here.
Sir, some attendees have requested you to share presentation if possible.
I told you in the beginning it's not possible because it's a work in progress. If you don't mind, we can they can contact me on email. I can discuss with them if some information is required.
Thank you, sir, for this informative session. Thank you all for joining. Also, we have a question from Rishikesh Raju.
Yeah.
Do we have the case of regeneration braking in fuel cell driven vehicle as like we have battery driven vehicles?
Yes, sure. So everything remains same. As I mentioned that ultimately you have both the battery as well as the fuel cell in fuel cell electric vehicle, and in battery electric vehicle you just have the battery. So the same, the regeneration is done in the fuel cell electric vehicle also for better performance. It's always there. Yeah, during deacceleration, this regeneration thing works.
Thank you, sir, for this informative session. Thank you all for joining.
Yeah. That's all.
Can the supercapacitor be used along with fuel cell to increase acceleration performance?
Yes, these things are state of the art research going on already. I'm not following this work, but yeah, I know from literature that these things are going on.
What parameters have you considered for optimizing battery size?
Again, so this is see, for battery sizing optimization, of course it is the like you have to make a balance, like because fuel cell, for example, if the motor rating that you are using is like say 100 kilowatt, so it, and you also have the drive cycle, and you can see that your drive cycle, the average power rating that you need is only 60 kilowatt, and only during acceleration or something you reach or when you start the vehicle you reach high power high torque requirement. So you can kind of now play with optimize the requirement of fuel cell power and the battery power in order to get the rating of battery that you need. So a lot of factors will come into play, like costing, like if you switch from 60 kilowatt to 80 kilowatt of fuel cell, what costing will increase. So can you compensate that 20 kilowatt with extra battery power? So yeah, so that's an optimization that you have to do actually. So there's no single answer to that.
So we have another question. Is energy required for production and storage of hydrogen justifies the usage?
Energy required for production and actually this is not see, production is what? Production is okay, you can do that water splitting, and there's no one source for hydrogen, what I mentioned in the beginning. So of course the green hydrogen you can produce from solar energy. If you use that solar energy for water splitting, you get the hydrogen that is free of cost in some sense, isn't it? So that green hydrogen, so you generated that green hydrogen kind of in a very green way and a cheap way, so that then compensate for the hydrogen production cost. So it's only the only the other things like compression of hydrogen and all that requires extra energy, but it's not only about the energy, but the benefit that hydrogen is going to give, or it's already giving, with zero emission on the roads, and of course the overall the zero emission cycle, right from the production to consumption, that is not possible in any other energy vector. So this is where hydrogen stands out.
Another question is, which type of energy management control strategies, for example, model predictive control, rule-based strategy, optimization-based strategy, are mostly used in case of fuel cell?
Yeah, again, no single answer to that. I think this is where the game of fuel cell systems, means the design principles of this fuel cell electric vehicle will come into play. So I think the optimization should be the key here, how you want to use the power from battery and fuel cell. So yeah, nothing else to say about anything else.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you all for joining. We would like to thank Aspire team for providing this platform. We would like to request you all to kindly visit aspire.iket.in. We have so many projects available for students and brand challenges. You can find the registration link on the Aspire website. Thank you all. Stay safe, stay healthy.
Fine. Thank you.